Amen. Amen. Thank you, Karen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Well, I am thrilled this morning to have our daughter back, and I'm going to ask Rebecca to come and just greet you this morning. We're glad to have her back from Thailand for a few weeks, and will you welcome our missionary this morning? Amen. No preaching, just share.
สวัสดีค่ะวันเช้านี้ฉันมีดิมฉายมากเพราะว่าพระเจ้าให้ฉันมีโอกาสมาเยี่ยมครอบครัว This morning I'm so thankful that God gave me the opportunity to come here and to be with you and to be with my family. God is good. So I've been living in Bangkok, just a quick update. I've been living in Bangkok for a year and a half, and then I moved to Chiang Rai. And God is good. I'm working with a small church there, and he's opening up a lot of opportunities for us to be able to build relationships in the community. I'm still learning the language. It's very hard. Thank you so much for all your prayers for my family and for me. And I believe that God's still going to do great things in Thailand. So thank you for all that you do for me.
Amen. Thank you, Rebecca. For those who weren't aware, Rebecca's flight was delayed in Tokyo for a full day. Must not be level up there. And watch out when the kids sing tonight. That might be a little... No, I'm just teasing. How many of you are coming back tonight? Come on. If you didn't make plans, change your plans. But get here early. I will tell you, seats will be at a premium tonight. They always are at children's events like this. Today you'll see open seats. We're hoping that maybe some of those people that come tonight, because a lot of the children that are in our program, they ride on our bus as well. And so we're hoping their parents will be here tonight, and hopes that maybe we'll touch their lives and they'll say, you know, we need to be in church too. And we can fill some more of these seats. Can I hear a good amen? Amen. So, you know, tonight's going to be an exciting night. But back to Rebecca. She was on her flight, and they said they had to do some scheduled maintenance. That maintenance went from an hour to 2 hours to 3 hours to 4 hours to finally they canceled the flight, put them in a hotel overnight, and said, you'll come home the next day, which was not real exciting to her because, I mean, when you get worked up, how many of you know when you get worked up for something and you put on hold, you're like, this is not good. And you get real disappointed. But we know that God works all things for his good and his glory. So we don't know what was going on with that plane, but we sure are glad they didn't take off when they were supposed to. Who knows? It might have not made it home. And we're glad she's here with us today. Amen. Amen. Been an enjoyable few days as she's arrived Wednesday night about 6:30, and we've had a good time, just family time, fellowshipping, and how many of you know what fellowship means? There you go, eating. Now, we have eaten, and we have eaten, and Donna made the comment yesterday, we're going to have to get Rebecca back home pretty soon, or we're all going to be so big. No, we're just teasing. But it's been, when she got in, we had to go to her. I said, where do you want to go for dinner? She was hungry, and she said, let's go to Joseph's. Anybody know where Joseph's is down on Main Street? Pizza place. Oh, I'm going to tell you, it'll make you hurt yourself. And so we started out with a bang, and we've been going hard ever since. So had a great time. Amen. Well, for the last several weeks, I've been sharing a theme talking about the Christ child. And we talked about the deity of the Lord Jesus Christ on that first Sunday. And then today I want to talk about The defining names of the Christ child. The defining names of the Christ child. So I want you to turn with me in your Bibles this morning to the book of Isaiah chapter 9, and we'll read verse 6 together. So while you're turning there, let me just say there are many names in the Bible that identify the Christ child, but I want to focus this morning on the names that are here in verse 6 in chapter 9. So as we look at this, I want you to get excited. I want you guys to wake up this morning. Anybody with me here? Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate that. You know, it's a whole lot easier to preach when I hear an amen. It's a whole lot more fun when I hear people that are alive and ready to receive something. Otherwise, it's like beating on dead wood. Come on. And it just don't work. Because come on, get with me this morning. Are you with me? Amen. All right. Let's look. Isaiah chapter 9 and verse 6 says this. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder, and his name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Let's pray. Lord, today I need your anointing. I pray that you will cause your word to come alive, and the Holy Spirit, you will touch our hearts and encourage us, Lord, to live for you the life that you would be pleasing unto you. Lord, minister to each and every heart and life and soul that's here, and God, we'll give you all the glory and all the praise for it. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Now, it's important to notice that in the Bible, God uses names. How many of you know that God gave the idea of using names? He did. Come on, think about it. Matter of fact, in Genesis chapter 1, whenever God created the heavens and the earth, the first thing he did was, it says that God called light day. How many of you know that this is the day the Lord has made? This is day. At nighttime, the darkness, he called night. And he called the expanse the sky. He called the dry ground land. And the waters that were gathered together, he called the seas. God called Adam, and he said, look, Adam, I want you to name all these animals. God knew that everything needed a name. This morning, if you didn't have a name, I guess I would be just saying, hey, you, and hey, you, and y'all. There you go. I don't even know if Hooty Hoot would work this morning. Come on. You wouldn't know what I'm talking about. But I want you to understand that God, in his divine order, understood that names were important. You know, Adam gave each animal a distinctive name. Now, how he came up with those names, I don't know. I guess God just paraded him in front of him, and he said, ah, that's a giraffe. Ah, that's an alligator. Ah, that's an elephant. Come on, are we here? Are you with me? He just said, that's what it's going to be. And from there on, that's what it was. Well, names are very important. Matter of fact, we think about this throughout the Bible, names often relate to some aspect of somebody's birth. If you think of a fellow by the name of Isaac, you would think of the theme laughter. You say, why laughter? Don't you remember what happened when the visitors came to see Abraham and they were there and Sarah was in the tent next door and here she was 90 years old and said, your wife is going to have a child, and she began to laugh. Laughter is related to the name of Isaac. Another one is Jacob. Jacob is, his name is deceiver, because he deceived his brother. He deceived his father. He deceived others. And so we know him as a deceiver. Also, we know the name of Moses. And Moses' name means drawn out. He was drawn out of the water. So everything has reference here. Names and titles often relate to some aspect of a person's character or his life. How many of you have heard of the term Alexander the Great? Okay, maybe you've heard of William the Conqueror. Maybe you've heard of Simon the Zealot. Maybe you've heard of John the Baptist, okay? How about, have you heard the name Jesus, the Savior? Hello. Hopefully you have heard of him. The name Jesus. The name Jesus. Jesus saves. Jehovah saves. Acts chapter 4 and verse 12 says, salvation is found in no one else. For there is no other name under heaven by to which men can't be saved or must be saved. Philippians 2, Paul says this. He says, at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. How many of you know that every knee will bow before him? Can I hear an amen? You see, Jesus is the Christ child. Jesus was foretold in Isaiah. Last week we talked about the prophecies of the Christ child, and we talked about many of them. But today I want to talk about the names that Isaiah saw and that he brought forth in Isaiah 9 and verse 6. So that first name we want to look at this morning is simply this: Wonderful. When you think of the term wonderful, I've kind of got in a habit, and I've catched myself and not even thinking about it, but it's just when people ask me when I'm out and about, they say, how are you doing? And I'll say, wonderful. How many of you know wonderful means I'm doing pretty good? I'm having a great day. Things are going well. Matter of fact, sometimes things aren't going so great, and people say, how are you doing? And I will say, wonderful. Why? Because I'm trying to get myself back into that wonderful mood. Hello. Things weren't going so well, and I want to be wonderful one more time. Are you with me? I want to have the joy of the Lord back in my heart. I want to have a good time with God. I want to rejoice in the Lord, for he is good. But when we think about the word wonderful, what does wonderful really describe? Well, when it comes to Christ, let me give you a couple thoughts. His birth was wonderful. Can I hear an amen? You know, when I look down here at this little table here in the foyer, and I see, as this had been up here, they moved it down for the play for tonight. But I want you to look at the Christ child. Can you imagine the experience of what those shepherds saw on that night when they left their fields after seeing that heavenly host? What it must have been like when they got to that little stable where Jesus was born. Wasn't it a wonderful sight to see the newborn king, the one who would save us from the sins that we had inherited because of Adam? The second thought that I would say about Jesus' birth is this, and the term wonderful when it describes Jesus is this: his life was wonderful. You know, Jesus was born to Mary and Joseph, and it was different. He wasn't like the other boys. He wasn't quite like his sister. Come on. Jesus was different. Matter of fact, he was the one that had this extra knowledge. Can you remember the day that they had gone to Jerusalem and he had departed from mom and dad and went into the temple? And mom and dad had started the journey back home, and they were going back home, and all of a sudden they looked around, where's Jesus? I don't see him. Where's he gone? And they went back and they found him. And the Bible says he was reasoning with the priests and the prophets and those that were there. And he was studying. Why? Because he was different. Because he was wonderful, if you will. Come on. His life was wonderful from the time of his birth to the time that he ascended up into the heavens and went on to be with the Father. You see, he's described also as wonderful because of his teachings were wonderful. Can you imagine the people that would come and listen to him as we read through the stories in Matthew and some of the stories where he was sitting on the side of the mountain and the crowds would gather and Jesus would be saying, blessed is he who, and blessed is he who, and blessed is he. How many of you understand? People came to hear the wonderful teachings that Jesus would talk about. People were blessed when Jesus would work the miracles and they would see the fish that would multiply and the bread that was multiplied. It was a wonderful experience because it was out of the ordinary. They had never seen anything like it before. It was wonderful. Matter of fact, when you think of his name being wonderful, think of the experience that happened with Peter, James, and John as they went up onto the top of the mountain. And there they were with Jesus, and all of a sudden, Jesus was transfigured. His body became radiant and glorious and white and bright and brilliant. And all of a sudden appeared two other men, like Elijah, Moses. How many of you know it was a wonderful experience for them? Manner, it was so wonderful. They were scared. It was so wonderful. They wondered if they should even be there. It was so wonderful. They began to wonder, should we go ahead and build a tabernacle for you guys? What should we do? And Jesus said, just keep it to yourself for a while. Hold on. Don't tell anybody what you've seen. Don't tell anybody what's going on. But just wait. There'll be a time when you can tell of what happened up on the mountain of transfiguration. How many of you know it was a wonderful experience? His life, his birth, his teachings, his miracles, his transfiguration, they were all wonderful. And here's one that you will say, well, how could this be wonderful? But his death on the cross was wonderful because it paid for the price of your sin. It paid for the price of my sin. His blood that was shed became wonderful as it began to wash away the sins of my life. Can you say amen? Think about it for just a minute. It wasn't just wonderful that he died. But it was wonderful that when they went to the tomb the next day, when they went over there on that third day and they found that tomb was empty, and the angel said, this Jesus whom you look for, he's not here, but he is risen from the dead, just like he said he would do on the third day. Can I hear an amen? It was wonderful when they got to the tomb and his body was gone because Jesus was alive. Think about it. As he was standing there on the mountain, in those last few days, just as he was about to leave after his resurrection, and the disciples were standing there with him, and he says, now go ye and tarry in the city of Jerusalem and wait until the gift that I promise has come. He says, don't go anywhere, don't do anything, don't pass go, don't collect $200. Anybody remember that game? Don't do anything until the Holy Spirit has come. And then all of a sudden, the Bible says in First Acts chapter 1 there towards the end, it says, all of a sudden, Jesus ascended into the heavens and their jaws dropped. Their eyes got big as saucers. And they looked and they said, wow. And the angels again appeared and said, this same Jesus, he'll come back just as you saw him go. How many of you are looking forward to that? What a wonderful experience. What a wonderful day. How many of you know the name of Jesus is wonderful? Not only did he ascend, but guess what? The Bible says he's interceding for you right now at the right hand of God, interceding on your behalf. That's wonderful. Come on, are you with me? His name is wonderful. And there's one more wonderful I want to tell you about. It's a day that's coming. It's called the second coming. It's a day when Jesus himself shall mount up on a big white horse. Are you with me? I'm not talking about the calling out of the church. That's going to be a good day too. But I'm talking about the second coming of the Lord, where he comes back with his heavenly host and all of those who have gone on to be with him. And they come back and he starts a new heaven and a new earth. And he rids this world of all of its sin and all of its worldliness and all the wickedness. How many of you know there's going to be a new heaven and a new earth after his second coming? It's going to be a wonderful day. Can I hear an amen? Not only is he wonderful, but number two, he is counselor. Now, don't get confused here. Sometimes we think counselor, we think about the counselor that Jesus said, I will send you. He said, don't be worried because I'll send you another comforter, another counselor. How many of you know who that is? Holy Spirit. But let's talk about Jesus, the counselor, a little bit first. Let's think about him. Wonderful counselor. As our counselor, he taught and he instructed. How many of you know Jesus, if you read the word, it puts wisdom into your heart. It puts wisdom into your spirit. It teaches us the right things that we should do. People say there are no absolutes, but I'm telling you this morning, this is the absolute truth. This is the gospel, the word of the living God. Can I hear it? Amen. You see, I want you to know there is a right and a wrong. Let me say it again. There is a right and a wrong. Our world today says, well, I don't know if there's right or wrong. You know, it's just kind of, let me tell you what, there is no gray area. Either you're for him or you're against him. Maybe I need to preach on this a little bit more. There is no gray area. Either you're living for him and you're sold out, or you're not. Is he your everything? His word teaches us how to live for him. Come on. His word teaches us how to behave. His word teaches us how to get along with everybody else. His word teaches us how to get into heaven. Can I say amen? Come on. You see, not only has he taught and instructed us, but he has equipped us and sent us out. How many of you know Jesus, he is the equipper. He's the one that taught us. You remember what Jesus did? If you look through the scriptures, Jesus took his disciples and he said, come on, follow me, and I will make you what? Fishers of men. After he taught them and he taught them and he taught them, the Bible says he sent them out two by two to go into every place and to witness and to share the gospel. And they weren't to take anything with them. They were just to go and trust the Lord. And then later we see where he sends out the 72. How many of you know that he equips and he sends out? He teaches us and he sends us out to do the work, to do the commandment that he gave to us, to go ye into all the world and to what? Preach the gospel. God wants us to do the work. He wants us to do that. As counselor, he not only taught, instructed, equipped, and sent out, but he has given us authority. All authority is given unto you. Come on. Jesus gave us authority. And one other thing that I'll say about him as counselor, he gives direction for your life. Anybody need direction sometimes? Jesus has given us direction. He is the truth, the light, and the way. The Bible says, no man cometh to the Father except through him. We looked at he is the wonderful, he is the counselor. Number three, he is mighty God. Mighty God. When I think of mighty God, he is all powerful. Let me say it again. He is all powerful. One more time. He is all powerful. He created everything. There's nothing impossible for God. Some of you this morning are sitting here and thinking about problems in your life. You're thinking about things that are going on and how you're going to make it, how you're going to get through this, how you're going to focus. And I'm here to tell you this morning, nothing is impossible with God. He is almighty. He is all powerful. He created everything. He is the mighty God. He is almighty. And he is the Son of the living God. Come on. Number four, he is the everlasting Father. I like this one. He's the everlasting Father. How many of you know with him there was no beginning and no ending? He just was. He always has been, and he always will be. Come on. He is everlasting. He doesn't run out. Have you ever gone to get your flashlight sometime, and you go to turn it on, and the light goes and dies? It just, or if you got some of those new kind of batteries, when they go dead, they're dead. I mean, they just don't work anymore. You know, the old Ever-Readies that we used to have that had a little strength to them, when they got a little bit weak, all of a sudden they go, and they got yellow and dim and dim and dim till you could just look at it straight in the eye and you still see a little glimmer. These new ones die out. I got a battery on my drill. And when that thing is going, the other ones used to go, this new one goes, it's over. You might as well just hang it up, get you another battery, or put it on the charger. One of the other. I want you to understand, when Jesus is there, he doesn't go, and he doesn't go, he doesn't wear out. He doesn't wear down. He doesn't dim, but he is always bright. He is always on target. He's always online. He is always, he is everlasting. Can I say amen one more time? Revelations 1 says this: He is the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, who was, who is, and who is to come. Come on, are you with me this morning? In John chapter 1, He was in the beginning with God. He's everlasting. In Hebrews chapter 13, let me go back to John chapter 3. He is the giver of life. He is everlasting. When it comes to life, you're going to have eternal life. Let me just say, eternal life, if you have Christ, is forever and ever and ever, and there is no end. You know, I never quite understood when I was a kid this millennial reign thing. How many of you know what I'm talking about? Millennial reign. Millennial reign is when the devil is bound for 1,000 years. Didn't quite understand all that to begin with. I heard of it, but it didn't make a lot of sense. But the Bible says in the end times, in Revelations, it says, as we see that he is bound for 1,000 years, and after 1,000 years, he will be loose for a short time. But after that short time, then he will be taken and put in chains, and he will be taken and placed down with the false prophet. And how many of you know the anti-Holy Spirit, if you will? He'll be put down in all those bad places, and he will be in the lake of fire, which burns forever for all those who do not accept Christ as Lord and Savior. He will be there forever and ever and ever. And those of us who accepted Christ will reign with him forever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever. And I could just keep going. Forever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever. It doesn't end. Goes on. Why? Because my God, my Savior, my Jesus, he reigns forever. Come on. Hebrews 13 says, he said that he would never leave us nor forsake us. That means he's going to be around all the time. How many of you know he's right there at your summoning? He's right there to listen to you, to hear you. Towards the end of the Bible in Revelation chapter 19, I quoted a little bit of this a minute ago, but talking about everlasting Father, he is called faithful and true. Come on. He is also known as the Word of God. He is also known as King of Kings and Lord of Lords, because it's written on his robe and on his thigh, those words. He is King of Kings and Lords of Lords. He will always be King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Can I hear an amen? And number 5 this morning, the 5th name that Isaiah gives him in chapter 9 and verse 6, he is the Prince of Peace. He is the Prince of Peace. Let me say it again. He is the Prince of Peace. How many of you know that without Jesus, there is no peace? Let me say it again. Without Jesus, there is no peace. Without Jesus, there is no hope. Without Jesus, there's no assurance. Come on. Without Jesus, you're lost. Without Jesus, there's no assurance that you will live forever. There's no assurance that you'll make it into eternity with God forever. Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 14 says, "For he himself is our peace. He became our peace. He died on the cross to bring you and I peace this morning." Amen. He shed his life blood so that we might have peace. Romans 5, 1 says, "Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ." Let me just say, if it hadn't been that Jesus died for your sins, you would have no peace. If it hadn't been that he gave his blood, you would have no peace, because there would be still hatred between you and God. But God allowed his son to die for you and for me so that we could have a redemption, so that we could be justified, so that we would be just as if we had never sinned. Come on. Because of him, we have peace with God. You know, people are dying all around us, and I've been around some folks as they were on their deathbed. And I've heard it said many times, not only in my assistance in helping people, but you would ask them this simple question: have you got peace with God? Do you understand what peace with God is? Knowing that your sins have been forgiven. Knowing that you have been justified through the blood of Jesus Christ. There's no other peace without Jesus. That is peace with God. Church, I couldn't leave this place this morning knowing that you don't have peace with God. My prayer is today, if there's someone in this church building today that is not at peace with God, you have not made it right with God, that before you leave this place today, that you will accept Him as your Lord and as your Savior, that He would come and bring peace into your life. You see, in Matthew chapter 11, Jesus said this. In Matthew 11, verse 28, He says, He came to give us rest. He says here, come to me, all you are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. How many of you know peace is being at rest, knowing there's no more struggle, there's no more strife, there's no more worrying about where I'll spend eternity. Everything's settled. It's all set and done. Now, let me just say, there are some folks that got that peace once before, but they've lost that peace. They've walked away from God. They've left Him. They didn't hang out at the foot of the cross, but they traveled away. And they went back into their sinful world. Aren't you glad this morning? The Bible tells us in 1 John 1:9, those who confess their sins can be forgiven. It says here in this passage that all we have to do is ask for forgiveness and He'll forgive us. How many of you know that Jesus loves you this morning? He cares for you. He loves you. As I bring this to a close this morning, though the names of Christ describe His character and His work, remember that there is no other name by which we can be saved, only but by the name of Jesus. Luke 19:10 says, for the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. If you go back and read that passage of Scripture in chapter 19 in Luke, it's a story where Jesus was passing by and there was a short man by the name of Zacchaeus. And he said, I want to see Him. I want to see this Jesus. I want to see this Master. But he was so short, he couldn't see through the crowds. He couldn't find Jesus as he walked by. So the Bible says that Zacchaeus went a little farther ahead. And he climbed up in a sycamore tree where he could get a good look at Him as He came by. And as He was coming by, Jesus looked up at him and He says, Zacchaeus, come on down. Because I want to have fellowship with you and you with me. How many of you know Jesus wants to have fellowship with you and I today? He wants to have a relationship with us. It's not just the prayer that you pray at the altar. It's not just a prayer that you say, Jesus, come into my heart. But that's just the beginning. That's like it says in Revelation 3:20, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man will let me in, I will come in and sup with him and he with me. Jesus is knocking at our door, but we've got to open the door and we got to let Him in and build a relationship with Him. And talk with Him and spend time with Him and learn to love Him. You know, yeah, if you're going to love somebody, your marriage relationship, Don and I can't last on just appearances and infatuation. It has to be built on love and respect for one another. Are you understanding what I'm saying? It's the same way with God. We have to learn to love Christ because He gave His life for us. We need to accept Him and love Him, and have a relationship with Him, and respect His desires, and live the way He would have us to live. In that Luke chapter 19, Jesus looked at the people, and they wondered why Jesus would go and have dinner with a man who was a tax collector. As far as they were concerned, he was a heathen. He was a wicked person. And Jesus said, I come to seek and to save that which was lost. He came after the lost souls today. Amen. Today, if you need a relationship with Jesus, He's here waiting for you. He's waiting for you. Will you stand to your feet all over this church? My Jesus, as I read in the book of Isaiah chapter 9, in verse 6, Once again, he says, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder. And his name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace."